Good morning. This unit relates to forensic reports and expert witness. So this will give you guidelines on writing reports of your findings for digital forensic investigations. And you'll learn about different types of reports, what to include in typical reports, and how do you examine, how do you generate reports, what are the format, okay, with forensics. And once you write reports to communicate the results of your forensic investigations, examinations of, say, a computer, a network, a system, or a digital forensic drive, a USB, for example, right? So typically, forensic reports present evidences that are that support further investigations, and in some situations, admissible in court at an administrative hearing or some affidavit being filed to support issuing, say, an arrest warrant. Or maybe a search warrant, right? So this report can provide a justification for a collection of more evidences, right? So the agenda that we have for today is looking at forensics reports. What are they? How do we design them? What is the organization of forensic reports, right? And primarily understanding the importance of these reports, okay? We'll also look at the documentation process that is involved when designing or writing these forensic reports. We'll look at case studies, okay? We'll look at hands-on case studies. We'll look at some sample evidence worksheets which are there filed by various forensic agencies. And then exactly what do they fill in, what evidence, you know, as samples. So we'll try and study all those. All right. Now we look at some expert witness. What exactly is involved when you try to think about expert witness? What do they do? How do they work with digital forensic people? And finally, we look at some Information Security Act by India. Right, Indian Information Security Act. It was designed in 2006, and then there was an enhancement done and appended. Okay, so when we talk about forensic reports, we are ideally looking at gathering information related to that case. The investigator, the forensic investigator, performs some researching, information gathering, which is like researched data, artifacts. Then all these things are also investigated, right, by the forensic investigator, and then communicated finally as the last step. All these things are returned back and communicated with the intended audience. Okay, so this is in a very simple way how reporting within forensics, within digital forensic works for investigations. Okay, now when you write reports to communicate the results, right, of your computer, of your network system, a digital device, a USB, for example, right, some emails, some number, credit card number, or something, some name, right, that you're researching. This forensic reports, it presents evidences of that, right, that supports further investigations, maybe, right, deeper investigations. And in some situations, these are directly admissible in law of, or in the court, okay, or maybe at an administrative hearing, right, or maybe just as an affidavit, right, which is to support issuing an arrest warrant, for example, of a search warrant, right. And then these reports can also provide justifications, right, for maybe collecting more evidence, much more time required, and then they can also be used as a plausible cause hearing, okay, as evidence for some grand jury hearing, right? So that is where these reports, these digital forensic reports, are referred to a lot of times. At times during a motion hearing within a civil or a criminal cases, these reports are also used. Now, in addition, if the employer is investigating, say, an employee, right, for some misconduct, for example, okay, so the report might be on basis of that disciplinary action the legal or the HR department has to take against that employee, right? Now, besides presenting facts, these reports contain expert opinions, okay? So, ideally, the forensic investigator collects all and everything that he can find out. Right. Then he does some examination on those facts or data that is generated. It might be noise, it might be junk, for example, right? But then you have to find out information from it, right? Once that information is gathered, some analysis is done, okay? And this involves checking with some people who are experts for their opinion, right? And then you could look at your result as your first testimony. Okay, so the reporting part, once you're done with collection, examination, analysis, and then when you write reports, when you generate reports, right, it is a first testimony for a particular case, right? You must expect to be examined and maybe cross-examined about it, right? Questioned, right, by the advocate, by some other people, right? Or even the opposition counsel, right, who's the opposite advocate, right, will look at and first opportunity to attack the facts that you present, right? He'll say they are wrong, you know, there's no credible evidence that you can present, you know, things like that. Whether you determine them yourself, or maybe extracted from others, or maybe some other reports, or maybe expected testimony of other witnesses. So you need to know what facts will affect your opinion and that particular report, right, which other facts may not. Right, for civil cases, including those involving some digital forensic investigations, right, there are a lot of courts that require expert witnesses to submit written reports, signed reports, right? And these state courts, they also, you know, they require reports from expert witnesses. Although the details of these may vary, right, depending on judges, depending on various courts. Therefore, if you are a digital forensic examiner involved in some civil case, you might write a report explaining your investigation and finding everything about it, right? Good, bad, what you found. Okay. Specifically, there are specific rules within several criminal procedures, okay, that require the parties who participate in calling an expert witness to testify, okay, and they must provide a copy of the expert written report, a signed report that includes all opinions. Right, the basis of those opinions, how they came to know. So from a content perspective, okay, the report that should be used, it should refer to the copy of the notice, right, what about the case, the disposition that is there related to that particular case, the jurisdiction that is there, right, a lot of different jurisdictions, different courts, specifically in US, okay, they have different rules, right? So jurisdictions, for example, say a district court in Washington and a district court in say in Texas, right? They might have different jurisdictions, different rules for the same thing, remember, right? Then you need to include the case ID, the date and location of that filing, and actually this about the scene, right, which is what is it all about, right? And then you need to include the style of the case, a formal report, right? The style of the case is basically the format that is used for official court documents, right? For example, using a header, for example, plaintiff versus defendant, you know, something like that. Now there are different ways in which you can present this. So one is basically a formal report, which is a written report, a preliminary or a basic report, initial report, right? Okay, so let's talk about the structure that is involved for reports writing, right? Now when we talk about the report structure for forensic reports, right, remember, anything you write as part of your examination for a report in a civil or a criminal litigation case is a subject to discovery, right, from the opposition attorney, right? Means that what you write can or will be given to the opposition attorney also, right? He can question you, right? So discovery is the process of opposing attorneys that seek information from each other, right? They can question and ask for more information, right? So written reports, written preliminary reports, right? The initial report, right? Which are created using some software tools or some you know using some data analysis, is considered a high risk document because the opposition counsel can demand discovery about it, right? Now, if that written preliminary report states a contrary or a more equivocal position, right, that you take in your final report or your testimony, you should expect the opposition counsel to try to discredit whatever findings you've done in your testimony by using that particular written report, the initial report. So it is simply better that there's no written report to provide, okay? If you must write a preliminary report, you should not use the words preliminary copy or a draft copy or a working draft, you know, these something like this. Things like these, they give away the opposition counsel an opening, right, for discrediting you and then making seem as if through the attorney you related, you contributed, and then what could be an independent, your own independent judgment, right? See, and which might be contrary to the final report, remember. So when you talk about the forensic template, right, so apart from executive summary, you got objectives, you got computer analyzed evidences, relevant findings, some supporting details, some investigative leads which might lead to further investigations, right? And then some additional subsections, right, related to that, some cases, some references. These might include the methodology, the user applications, some internet activity, you know, some recommendations, right, to, so as to speak. So all kinds of things can be added in this, but the basic fundamental or the basic organization structure should be clearly marked, right, demarcated as it is called. Now when we talk about report quality, right, so I've discussed about writing clear reports, you know, proper reports. So the very important aspect of report quality, right, to produce clear, concise reports, the digital forensic investigators, they should assess the quality of writing, right, and then ideally following some criteria, right, some of which I can share here, right. One is being communicative, right? So communicative quality, right? Now it is very, how easy is it to read, right? Is it simple to understand? Think of your readers, okay? Think of it from their perspective and make this report, make the writing process or the writing style appealing to them, right? Remember, these guys are non-technical people again, right? It might be a legal guy, he might be an advocate, he might be some other expert, right? So your report should be written in such a way that it appeals to them, right? They can understand it easily, right? Ideas and organizations, right? Now, is the information relevant and clearly organized, right? That is the fundamental thing, right? I told you about writing, very specific title, you know, a summary or an abstract, right? So that is what will make them interesting to read the further into that particular section. Right, grammar and vocabulary, right, very very important, right? Is the language simple, right, and direct to that meaning, is clear or not, whether the text isn't repeating, right? However, technical terms should be used consistently. You shouldn't try to use variety of these terms, right? Use different words for for example, using different words for the same thing, right, might raise some questions, saying, you know, is it a good report, you know, maybe, might be, shall, you know, things like these, right? Punctuation and spellings, again, are they accurate, are they consistent? A badly written report, right, if somebody runs a grammar report or a spell check and then finds out some punctuation spelling mistakes, then obviously the quality of that report again goes down, right? It might not be taken seriously, right? So good reports or good expert reports, right, they may share many qualities of other kinds in writing, right? To write is to think. A report should lay down the ideas in a very logical order, right, that the people can understand, right, in every sentence, follow it from the previous one, right, building up an argument piece by piece, right, and group related ideas and sentences, you group them into some paragraphs, right, and group paragraphs into sections, so that it creates a flow from the beginning of the report to the end, right, or maybe a page or a title, for example, right, a section, right. Now this report could be grammatically sound, have correct spellings, and it should be free from all written errors, right. Avoid jargons, right, slangs or colloquial terms or some short forms, right, TCP/IP, for example, right, email, some other term for email, right. Now most lawyers, judges, and these, they aren't technically trained, remember, right? So if very high end technical terms are being used, right, so you either define them in a very simple ordinary language which refers readers to your glossary, right, if they see something, they can go to the glossary and understand what it is, just a one line definition, right? So, and defining acronyms that you use, right, it is okay to use acronyms, but whatever acronyms you are using, right, define them in such a way so that any abbreviations, they are not used as a standard measurement, right? Particularly if they are important, right? Spell out all the acronyms the first time they are used, if there's any possibility of misinterpreting them or mis Now I talked about sharing some forensic templates, some sample reports. So now let's look at some of these reports. Okay, so a simple report, a forensic template might look at something like this, right? It might have some from, some introduction, some assessment done, some analysis, some expert opinion, right? So you might want to look at the introduction, for example, right? What is being done? So this is just a sample report again, right? It might include some analysis by the investigator, right? For example, where you explain, analyze the causes, the process that occurred, that might result in some evidence being collected later, right? And finally, you might have some expert opinion, right, which can be drawn as a conclusion from all these things, okay? Analysis for the expert team, for the expert witness, right, for confirming what was used. Okay, so all these things are basically categorized in very simple and straightforward manners. Okay, further, if we look at for example another report, so this is again a digital forensic report, X versus Y, right? Prepared by somebody, the investigator's name, what is his field, what is his specialist area, on behalf of, right, and what is it all about, right? Then you have the table of contents, which would include the introduction, the summary of the case, the statement of compliance, forensic examination, what tools, what change of custody, right? Evidences, right? Evidence one, evidence two, and then categorizing them, right? Some summary of conclusion that is there, right? So all these things, clearly categorizing, clearly identifying what is involved, right? And then you have the further the body of the report, right? Introduction, right, which basically has a summary of the case and what tasks, right? The statement of compliance, right, and some forensic investigation that has been examination that is being done, right? So for example, what tools are being used? So the investigator might be asked to give out some information about X tool. Why only that tool is being used? Why not some other tool? Right? What is the advantage? What is the output that was generated? Right? Further, if we check the artifact section, right? How they were extracted? What analysis was done? For example, file password decryption, right? And then how is the chain of custody being handled? Right? Again, this is very very important, right? Who is handling the artifacts? How is the chain of custody being made? So the description of evidence, right? And then who and what time, who was it endorsed by, who received it, right? Their location, you know, some comments about what is going on, what was shared, right? Everything in very clear detail, the date and time included, right? And item one for each item again, okay? If it is being handled by multiple people, this report has to have their names, their IDs, their dates, time, who received it, with a signature, of course. Okay, now again, like some guy received it, official address, his email address, his contact, even the evidence classes, right? You classify evidence in various ways. So payroll copies, soft copies, communication emails, all emails into one section, into one class, right? And some hard disk related information, right? What was found, right, into another class, if there's another hardware involved, for example a USB drive involved, right? So that will be put into some other class, right? Technically, the exhibits, the logs, the proofs that we have, right, they are clearly exhibited, like exhibit A, exhibit B, right? So that anybody non-technical guy can easily look at it and then understand what is going on, right, if they want to go into further details, right? And then how you are concluding them, how you came to that particular conclusion is also referred to that, right? So, and then the exhibits might have core technical stuff, right? Because these might be examined by further expert witnesses, right? So remember to include everything, right? If you want to give out something, you can mark it somewhere within these reports as well. or you can just put in these screenshots which are generated from computer generated tools, right? Forensic tools directly, right? That is also a very good way of presenting your reports. So when we talk about forensic reports, further on details about findings, right? What exactly do you include in these exhibits, in these findings? First of all is specific files related to that request. Another is other files, including some deleted files that support the findings, right? Another is a string of searches, keywords, for example, some keyword search that you use, or some text string that you used, right? Also internet related evidence, right? It is very critical, right? From a digital perspective, right? So website traffic analysis, for example, right? A browser history, for example, right? Chat logs, cached files, some data in the temporary folder of a computer, for example, right? Cookies, for example, in a web browser, emails, right? That was interacted, right? News group activities, right? Wherever this guy was chatting, whether he was a part of some activity, social networking, where he was posting something, where he was chatting something, right? You can create a lot of information, a lot of profiling about a particular guy, right? As also graphic images, right? Whatever is found, whatever was undeleted, for example, right? Recovered data, right? Some of them might be graphics, right? Graphic images. So analyzing them for metadata, maybe trying to find out geolocation, maybe trying to find out how they were clicked, right? From a particular phone, what application was used, what version was used, what date time they were clicked, things like these, all metadata analysis, right? This would indicate ownership, right? Who clicked, if it was clicked from a suspect's phone, for example, right? And it confirms that a particular software was used, a particular version was used, and the phone also has the same thing, right? So you can, it indicates ownership, right? So it was clicked using his ownership only, right? And which also includes program registration data, things like these, or data analysis, for example, right? A lot of files have been deleted, sent, maybe WhatsApp chats, for example, WhatsApp interactions, for example, or e-commerce, for example, people buying stuff, right? So data analysis, right? And then also description of relevant programs on those examined items, right? A laptop may have some image editors, things like these, which might be pointing to, which might be indicators to the ownership of the accused, saying he was playing around with graphic images, for example, or audio images or audio content, right? Or video editors, right? Things like these, right? And then if there are techniques being used to hide or mask data, right? For example, just assume the accused is technically proficient, right? So he's able to hide some file somewhere, right? So if he's using the techniques like encryption, steganography, hiding some partitions, some attributes, hiding files or masking data simply, right? So all these things can all be also included in the forensic report for as details of finding that you've found out, right? And then of course file name anomalies, right? Renaming a document file, for example, to an Excel file, or having a PDF file as a executable file, things like these. These are anomalies which people normally don't do, right? So things like these can always help in a case where you can put them as details of findings. Now we talked about evidences and findings, right? So exhibits, very very critical exhibits which are having details, date, time, details about them, right? And inferences or summaries at the end, right? All these should always be included in the reports. So exhibits, what is the analysis that has been done, right? For different exhibits, right? So which would give you, or which would give the jury or the jurisdiction people or the advocates a lot of confidence that the report is actually correct, and it is it can be handled, it can be worked upon in a very simple way, right? There as less questions come up, right, it is always better, and for the reputation as well. Now if you look at further, right, so technical evidences, for example, some hash files were generated, or some data was, you know, some keyword related information, right? So at what time was that keyword searched, what application was used, who was the author, right? Metadata about or data analysis about documents, right? So all the stuff will be highly technical, right? Core technical stuff, right? So all that part should also be involved in these forensic reports as a detailed and a deep investigation system inside it, right? So for example, and then once all these exhibits are done with proper evidences, so there's no point where anyone can question that report, right? And then a summary of conclusions can be reached up, which is like an expert opinion from the investigator side regarding the findings that have been done, right? And then of course these are signed off, right? So a signature of the expert witness as well as the whoever witnessed it, right? Whoever was there in the lab, it is always done in front of them, right? So exhibits, detailed technical, highly core technical stuff, which the lawyers and the judges and the legal guys might want to look at, but a summary of conclusion reached with by that expert witness, right? And then finally, I talked about evidence, appendix, right? So appendix can be, you know, and put at the end of the report, right? Where all these, you know, whatever keywords or whatever things have been used, right? They can be, you know, clearly specified what was being used, what is being said for a particular report, right? And then sample of whatever data is there, right? Word documents are there, some files are there, some ISO is there, right? All independent auditor reports, right? From various people, from various experts, right? A third party, a third people, right? Everything should be included in such reports. All right. Now, when we talk about such reports, right, they should have everything and anything that is there, right? But from an investigator's perspective, you add and you want to prove whatever you are coming up with, whatever your conclusions are, right? So you highlight them. You might add everything, but you highlight your own inferences that you might present at the end, right? So again, detailed report, right? So you credit to somebody who kind of helped you, and then maybe high priority, low priority, you know, priority wise you can always mention what was you know what was the outcome of your inferences, and then categorize them, summary, right? So it is very easy for people who are non-technical to understand and then make sense of what is going on. All right. Now, when we talk about documentation process, right? So always ensure if you are the digital investigator, forensic investigator, you take notes while when you're consulting with the case investigator or the prosecutor or somebody who was involved on the ground, on the floor, right, or at the crime scene for that particular case, right? Also maintain a copy of the search authority, right, with that case notes. You should also maintain an initial request for assistance, okay, with that case file, because you never know what specialized you know, domain you might get into, right? So always have an initial request for assistance if you're being asked to cover up, right? Also have a documentation regarding the chain of custody, right? What was gathered, what information, who was handling it, when was it handled, where was it stored, how many times has it been taken out to be reviewed, you know, things like these. All this comes under that chain of custody documentation, and always have this in your documentation report, in your forensic report. As far as possible, always take detailed notes, right, which are enough to allow for complete duplication of actions, right? For example, some accused, he set up some particular application, okay, and he was using that, right? So always have enough detailed notes if there is some configuration change that he performed, some path that he added, some files which he made executable, or something, right, that he did. So always have enough actions, enough information, enough notes, so that you can duplicate whatever he did on his machine into your lab systems. And of course, regarding lab systems, always maintain these lab systems in an environment which are away from the main networks, right? So these are typically called as sandboxing environments, where you create something, you deploy something, and then you delete them right, whenever it is not required. So whenever you're taking notes, right, date, time, description, and result, right, always include things like these as part of your action for reports, right? Always document irregularities which were encountered or any action that was taken regarding the irregularities that you faced during an examination. And it can be against anyone, right? The accused, his families, his friends, whoever is coordinating, even the police guys, right? Whoever allowed you or did not allow you access, right? Always document whatever action, whatever irregularities you face during your own your own investigation. It might well lead into some other stream or some other path being opened up for investigation further, right? And always include additional information, right? Network systems being used, which is typically network topology, right? Wi-Fi, what kind of Wi-Fi, what was the connectivity being done? Is he using two connectivities to internet service providers? A list of authorized users that he created, you know, some user agreements, legal agreement that is there, or some passwords, right? A lot of times accused would have a Wi-Fi and then also using somebody else's Wi-Fi. So has he broken into somebody else's network, right? All those things should always be looked into. Document all these changes that the accused or the people who are involved made changes into the system, the network, or at the direction of any law enforcement or even the examiner, for example, right? Always document everything, right? Never ever think that this was a routine thing and we should always bypass it. Nothing happens in a routine way, right? So document operating system related like information like software versions, current or detailed installed patches, for example, right? Anything that might be useful, right? Always document them. Document information that you obtain at the crime scene regarding remote storage, remote user access, or some maybe offsite backup that he was using, like OneDrive, for example, Google Drive, right? So he was copying and syncing all his data somewhere, right? So always try to gather information like these, okay? So let's look at a case study, okay? I just renamed it as case study number one, right? So just imagine there's a subject, right? He owned a roofing company, okay? Now this subject, he gave his laptop computer to an employee to take to a computer repair shop. Let's call it mom and pop repair shop, right? Because it has a display problem, some monitor issues were there. So he might be the owner, right? He gave it to an employee, right? Now once the laptop was repaired, right? So the repairing person, right, started the laptop to ensure that the monitor has been fixed. He may have replaced, say if it is a laptop, he may have replaced the LED or the LCD, okay? So once to ensure that it has fixed, right, as a standard procedure, right, they usually go to the recent menus, the start bar, and then select a few files for using, right, just for viewing whether they're opening up, whether there's any lag or some tilt or some bar or something is there on the display side, right? That's a regular procedure to check and open files for viewing, right? Or maybe just open up a Word file and then type something, whether it is displayed correctly or not, right? So that's a standard procedure that is followed, right? Now as soon as they opened that file, so the computer repair guy was presented with what appeared to be an image of a young child depicted in some sexual explicit manner, okay? So immediately that repair guy phoned the police station, the cyber cell, right? Cyber cell responded back and observed the image, right? Confirmed it is a violation of the statute, right? Now this laptop was seized because it contained something that is not legal, okay? This seizure was performed in a very consistent manner, and they had some recommendations being done, Right, so this laptop was entered into that evidence according to the police policy, the agency, the cyber investigation agency, and a search warrant was obtained for the examination. Right, and finally the computer was submitted with the for examination. Right, so this is the initial case study that we have. Okay. So now our objective is to determine whether the subject possessed the child pornography content. It was so it is complicated by the number of people who handled it, right? So there's a subject who owned the laptop, he gave it to a repair shop, who repaired it, or there might be somebody else who repaired it, and then somebody opened that file, right? And there is the police cybercrime involved as well, right? Now the computer type is a generic laptop with some serial number. Okay, and there's an operating system which is Windows 10 operating system involved, right? So this is the data that we find out during the our information gathering process, right? So the offense is possession of child pornography. The case agent is say investigator X, okay, and there's some evidence number, right, against that particular thing, and there's a change of custody. So we have a referred form where we would fill in the chain of custody details, right? And where the examination took place, the criminal investigation unit, the cyber crime team, right? All those things will be entered, right? And what tools were used, data acquisition utility or ISO creation, you know, universal graphic viewer, command line, you know, what was used. All these things are then compiled and written in that cyber forensic report, okay? So assessment, when you talk about assessment, the reviewed the case investigator's request for a service, right? The search warrant which provided legal authority to be looked into, all right? The investigator was interested in finding all information pertaining to say child pornography, right, or access dates and ownership of the computer. Now it was determined that the equipment needed was available in the forensic lab. From a resource perspective, right, I talked about asking assistance, right? So the equipment is there, finally it is there, right? Next step is acquisition. So we did an assessment, right? We asked for some support, which is there, then we go for some acquisition. Acquisition is the hardware configuration was documented and a duplicate of that hard disk was created, right, in a manner that protected and preserved the evidence. So typically ISO is created, right? So that, and that laptop, the original laptop, is kept away, right? Nobody touches that. CMOS information and the date, time, you know, how many times, the logs from that computer file, from that computer system, are all documented. Next is the examination, the next step of you know, going towards the creating reports, right? So examination part, right? So a directory, file structures, including files, dates, times, everything is recorded. Right, a file header search is also conducted, which would locate all the graphic images, right? Maybe there are more images, right, not just one, right? And if say for example all graphic pornography images were found, all these are reviewed, and only those files containing images of what appeared to be children depicted in sexual explicit manner are preserved as further evidence, right, for further details, right? And then shortcut files that are recovered, that pointing to files, floppy disk, some USB drive, something, right, all explicit sexual explicit files involving children particularly, all those are also documented. And then the last access time, the date of these files, which indicate the files were accessed maybe 10 days before it was sent to for repairs, right, all that point of time, till that time the files are documented. Okay, so this completes the examination part. So now we start upon documenting and reporting our findings, right, as and creating a digital forensic report. Okay, so documenting and reporting involves the investigator you know, being given a report describing the findings for that particular examination. The investigator determines that he needed to conduct, for example, interviews, right, apart from the data that he collected, the files, right? So next step would involve say employee who delivered that laptop to that shop, the repair shop, was interviewed, and he would indicate that he never operated the laptop, right? It was closed, it was shut down, it was given to him. He took it on X date, time, and then delivered it to that particular repair shop, right? Further, the employee would be subjected, stated that the subject, maybe he had shown images of sexual nature involving children on that laptop, right? Would further substantiate the claim, right? The subject who is being accused would have told that employee that he keeps pictures of floppy disk at his home or some USB drives, right? And he just forgot this one image on that laptop, right? So that is again something that can be documented or reported. The attorney office, right, they can be briefed in the hope of obtaining a search warrant of that subject's home from this statement, right, based on the examination of digital evidence and interviews of people, right, in his maybe office. So then a warrant can be drafted, presented to a judicial official, right, and then of course signed, right, and then during subsequent search, maybe some floppy disks or some USB drives, some hard disks might be discovered in that subject's house, right? Now, forensic investigation of these drives and data again would reveal, if they reveal, additional child pornography, which includes images of what the subject was, whether he was a participant, for example, right? And this would immediately result in his arrest of that particular person, right? So that is how, in a very simple way, as a case study, right, in basic steps, right, we can easily create the process. So when we talk about reports, right, this is how, as an example, investigators file reports, right? So for media analysis, for example, the subject is forensic media analysis report, subject name, right, case number something, right? The status would be closed, right? The summary of findings initially, right? What was found, right? So this is the abstract, right? X number of files found, which appeared to be, sexually depicted. Some shortcuts found on floppy drives or USB drives or some Google drives, and every file, every item is tagged. Okay, if there was a laptop, it is tagged. If there was a file, it is tagged. If there was a USB drive or a floppy drive, it is tagged, right? And whatever files in those items, the location of that particular system or the data is actually depicted, right? And whatever documents, for example, and there's a glossary, right? Then there's a shortcut which also links to other files, and then signed off, right? Whoever found, and whatever items have been provided, right, for that particular report are also mentioned in a very clear, in a very simple manner. Okay, so the idea is to present a very simple report, readable report, right? You might have done, data analysis and all sorts of tools might have been used, but from a legal perspective, they are only interested in the number of files that are found for legal perspective. They don't want to understand your legal, your technical stuff, right? They are only looking at legal stuff. All right. Now, as an example, sample evidence of worksheet she can also be used, right? So where you can write a case number, exhibit number, lab number, something, a control number, for example, a date, time, manufacturing model, if it was a computer, for example. So you write the manufacturer, right? You mention the model name, you mention the serial number of that particular system, examiner markings, right? Color, code, model, make, right? Desktop, laptop. The condition of the system, the item, the computer, right? Whether it is good, whether it is damaged, number of drives it may have, number of floppy drives, USB drive, modem, network cards, some tape, some USB drives, zip drives, maybe CD, right, or a DVD, right? If it has a drive, so that might indicate to further, looking into some other evidences, right? And then CMOS. Right, so whether it has a login or not, what was the current time, the CMOS date, time, version of that CMOS, right? All sorts of details are actually compiled in a very simple evidence worksheet. So I talked about CMOS drives, right? So CMOS hard disk settings, right? What is the capacity of the hard disk, right? Whether it is auto drive, number of cylinders, heads, sectors. whether what mode, right? Auto mode, legacy, normal, LVA, anything that is highly technical, you just tick and then mark it out. If there are two drives, for example, so you add another drive number two, drive number one, right? And then what was found, where they were found, what is the item type, item number, some sub number, right? You can add exhibit details here, right? So anyone wants to know, so okay, so let's look at exhibit number 10, right? So that sub number would be 10, the type would be an image, where it was found would be the path of that location, right? And some remarks, all right? Now relating to hard disks, right? There might be say two hard disks, for example. So manufacturer, model, serial number of that hard disk, capacity, cylinders, heads, sectors, whether it is a IDE, whether it is a SSD, how many pins, if it is a SCSI drive, right? And if there's a master jumper or a slave, master slave disk, right? If it is cable connected. Some parameters, right? Whether it is a partition disk, a Linux disk, what kind of a hard disk does it have? What is the, if there are multiple partitions, for example, right? What is the capacity, cylinders of those drive, whether it is bootable or not? What do each partition confirm to, right? And this can be done for every disk that is there, right? So names, bootable or not, how does it start, how does it end, where does it start, right? And what is the type, right? What is being used, what is the content in that, things like these are always useful for any for further investigation details. Further, we can also add parameters related to hard disks, right? Some addressable sectors, some of formatted capacity, volume labels, or maybe some archive method if he was using some kind of a backup, right? Online backup or some tape backup or some NT backup, some tar file, something, right? Then what platform was being used? DOS, Windows, Linux, Unix, what version? Some analysis software base that was there, Encase or some Unix, Linux, and whether it was stored or not, whether it was validated or not, what utilities are being used for that particular evidence analysis, right? So utility, version, and the purpose, right? In a very simple way, tag-wise, you can mention so that anyone wants to further replicate that, they can always pick up from your report and then take it up in a further detailed manner for further investigations. Now let's talk about expert witness. Okay, so expert witness are professionals. They might be judicial, ID, or legal people, right? Now these people are highly trained, okay, and these people, depending on your attorney's needs, right? Whenever he needs a consulting expert or a witness, expert witness, right? He might ask the opinion and technical expertise instead of testifying in the court. So this role is typically called as consulting expert, right? If the role changes from a consulting expert to a expert witness later, however, previous work as a consulting expert is subject to discovery, right? By that opposing people or the opposing the opposite side, right? For this reason, never ever record conversations on phone calls. Right now, so when investigators appear in federal court or court of law as an expert witness, civil rules, civil rules of civil procedures RPC, right, requires them to provide some information, right? On so one of them is cases in which they may have testified as experts at a trial or some deposition in some preceding 3 4 years, published writings were in maybe 10 years, right? And then previous compensation or services they've offered and received, right, while giving testimony. So this creates a confirmation of. All right, let's just talk about the Indian Information Technology Acts, right, or Act, right? This came up into force on 17th October 2000, right? The Indian Information Technology Act is 2006, right? So that is the IT Act as we know. Now this was appended in 2008, and a few sections, some information was introduced, which typically is Section 66A, offensive messages. Section 69, which gives power of interpretation, decryption of any information. And then penalties for child porn, cyber terrorism, and voyeurism. Now, the IT Act at the moment as it stands has 90 sections. So what does this act do? It provides a legal framework for e-governance or electronic governance by recognizing electronic records and of also digital signatures. So this is really critical. Earlier, nothing was there, right? So a document, a PDF document, legally signed or digitally signed by someone was not admissible. Now it is allowed, right? So this act establishes a tribunal which can resolve disputes for various people, right, or various groups of people, individuals, organizations, and then society at large. Okay, now how does it do? What are the different types of crimes that are involved for society at large, right? So against individuals, we can have harassment through email, cyber stalking, dissemination of some obscene content, defamation, hacking or cracking, as it is called. Hacking is not bad, but cracking is bad, right? And this might involve breaking into somebody's system, cracking their passwords, impersonating them, right? Sending out emails on their behalf, or deleting their data, or just looting their data, right? Taking it away, and some indecent exposures also. For individual property level, right? It might be IT infrastructure vandalism, malware transmissions, network trespass, illegally getting into somebody's network, unauthorized access, and then again hacking and cracking. Against organizations, this might involve hacking, cracking again, right? Phishing, okay, sending out emails to fool people, to lure them to give out sensitive information, which might be their IDs, their passwords, something, you know, which can be used by the attackers. And then to gain unauthorized access, perform cyber terrorism, distribution of pirated applications or operating systems, for example, right? Against society at large, so this can involve pornography, polluting the youth through indecent exposures, and trafficking, right? A lot of illegal e-commerce players are there out there, right, which are doing illegal trafficking, which is like not allowed to be sold in India, but they're still doing it, right? So all these are various types of crime that are there, and you know, that is where these acts are operating against, right? So that is all for this unit. So thank you, and all the best for your future.